real honor to be here. We are, as a church, in the middle of a kind of 8 to 10 week series on Proverbs called Wisdom for Life. And I have to tell you that I am really pressing into some discomfort because particularly in the last, I'd say, 6 hours since I got up this morning, the Lord's really been prompting me to almost set aside the outline and the sermon that I had, and just that he has had something really, you know, really powerful to say. And so I'm going to ask for your grace as I step into some discomfort and really just try to be a vessel for the Lord's word, because I know, and I know that you know, that whatever he has to say is far, far greater than what I do. But anyway, so, you know, I really want to speak to everyone that right now, as we're sitting here and we step into this, I'd like everyone to take off their hat as a Christian or a seeker, as a young person, as an old person, and step into being human. I think what the Lord has for us today has a lot to do about being human and taking down how we see other people and how we see ourselves sometimes, how we judge, sometimes consciously and unconsciously, and just have a moment to sit in some humility, but also some confidence of the Lord, and just try to see a different perception. I'm going to do something crazy here, and down in the back in the tech booth, I'm not sure I'm even going to pull up any of the slides. So I'll let you know if I'm going to, but I'm just going to kind of go with this. I want to look at a concept that is in Proverbs, but it's not just in Proverbs. It's in the whole Bible. And it is not only in the whole Bible. It is in our society, in our psychology, in our sociology. It is blindness. Blindness to ourself, to our heart motives. Blindness to other people. Blindness to our circumstances. And maybe kind of look at that from, like, do a 360 view, kind of look at it from all different aspects, because I think as many people as are already here today, that's as many perspectives. Every single one of us is on an individual journey. There's going to be seasoned saints that are sitting here, and there's going to be people who don't believe. And I believe that God brought everyone here for a reason. So I guess the first like viewpoint that I want to look at blindness and maybe self-deception with is from the Bible. I'll start, well, because we're doing a season on Proverbs. Proverbs 16:2, it does say, "All a person's ways seem pure to them, but our motives are weighed by the Lord." What this scripture is talking about is something, again, that is a theme that goes throughout the entire Bible. Our motives are weighed by the Lord. That's kind of a key thing here, because There's our external behaviors, like how we step out in life, how we treat people, whether we wake up in a good mood, you know, kind of our external, you know, the way that we act. But underneath that, there's also the seeds and the roots of it's the origin of where those behaviors come from. And, you know, for those of you that know the Bible, this is a massive theme. You know, we talk about trees and the fruit that grow on trees, but ultimately that's what's visible to the naked eye and to people, but underneath is the root. And the roots is the DNA of the tree, and that's what causes, you know, apples or oranges or pecans or whatever is growing on that plant. And it's just, it's amazing because I'm not going to go deep here, but just to kind of show how pervasive this theme is in the Bible. You know, if you think about it, in Genesis, the Ten Commandments are given to Moses. They're all about behaviors. Don't lie, don't kill, don't cheat, don't murder. You know, there's the Ten Commandments. Those are outward behaviors. But then you skip ahead, and the other side of that is, of course, Jesus' Sermon on the Mount, which is saying, okay, yeah, it actually is important how you behave, but just as important to the Lord is the jealousy, the envy, the impatience, the pride that's underneath, that's in your heart. And both of those things grieve the Lord. Another, like, very well-known parable is the parable of the prodigal son. That's, I think, Luke 15:11 ish. And, you know, there's two brothers. The younger brother is just like completely openly and visibly, you know, squanders his inheritance, and he goes and you know, he's exactly the example of what most of us would think of as being someone that's derailed and not making good decisions. The older brother wants very much to do the right thing. And he stays home, he takes care of his parents, like he's obedient. And yet the meaning of the parable, the point of the parable is actually both sons are equally lost. They are equally kind of blind to the inner heart motives that are causing their behavior, and they both need salvation. So those are kind of some biblical examples of how the Lord wants us to be careful about, wants us to be aware of the fact that we often judge other people for their external behavior, and we often or almost always are somewhat blind to really the inner heart motives. One quote that I really liked, because it just hit me. For those of you who know me, I love listening to Tim Keller. So this is what he said: self-deception is not the worst thing that you can do, but it is the means by which we do the very worst things. That just really, really hit me a lot. And so that's an example of the Bible, that how it's talking about blindness to ourself, to our motives, and self-deception. But it is also, and well, I guess I don't want to say those particular examples are also looking a lot at like how we look at ourself and the difficulty that we face at looking at ourself. But if I look at a different angle here, I want to look at blindness from a contemporary, secular point of view, as well as it's more of a blindness, not about how we can, you know, we can convict ourselves of a way that we're doing wrong, but it's also a blindness that sometimes we can feel despair and a lack of hope, and we don't need to. So this is a quote from the New Yorker magazine from last week. It was in the editor's journal, and it just, like, it just hit me because it speaks to how so many people are feeling right now. This is what it said. If our current moment has a defining impulse, it's the drive to feel good again. Seemingly every new book and television show concerns itself with characters' psychological woundedness. Faddish treatments and self-improvement regimes appear with the seasons. And yet, after the pandemic, hundreds of thousands of us remain sick, isolated, and out of sorts. Each week seems to bring alarming new headlines of widespread distress, loneliness, and this is particularly true among adolescents. And this is what got me. What tools, however imperfect, do we have for coping with despair? How might we all begin to feel better? The writer, who is a psychiatrist, goes on to say, our mental health is not about feeling good or calm or relaxed. It's about having feelings that fit the circumstances that you're in. There are a lot of differences. Like if I take Proverbs 16:2, a person's ways always seem pure to them. And this last statement, despair comes from not having feelings that fit the circumstances you're in. There are a lot of differences, but if you think about it, the roots underneath those are both about perception. Are you perceiving your circumstances accurately? Are you perceiving yourself accurately? Are you perceiving others accurately? What the Bible tells us is that self-deception is part of the human condition that's not going to change. We're not going to outgrow that. There's been tons of scientific, medical, you know, advances. You know, if you think about, you know, most of us would think that human beings or that our society is better off, that we've made progress than it was, say, in the Middle Ages or 3,000 years ago. And sometimes that's true. Some medical advances are fantastic. But there are also fundamental truths in the Bible about our human nature that are the same yesterday, today, and always. They're never going to change. And I don't think human beings are ever going to outgrow our struggle to perceive ourselves and our situation accurately. Looking at a couple different examples. So maybe one of the reasons that I think there are a lot of reasons why I picked kind of blindness and self-deception to talk about today. But one of those reasons is because there's a fresh manna in my life and in my family that is kind of working through this. I do want to state There are many kinds of blindness and different levels, different degrees. And this example that I'm going to give is not, it's not in any way a spiritual blindness, but I wanted to share it because it is a kind of a blindness that I just felt is so relatable. It is so, so relatable. So my family, my parents who are joining me today, and my brother and sister-in-law and my husband Jeff and I have been navigating a family member who is entering the last season of his life. This is an amazingly, amazingly kind and gentle person. But like so many of us, his age snuck up on him. And so it's just fresh for me that I've been going to the Lord. I've been thinking a lot about, you know, what am I blind about in my life? How come age sneaks up on us? How come we're constantly behind the eight ball? It's like, oh man, like I could do this 5 years ago. Why can't I do this now? And I've just been seeing kind of an unplaying of this to, you know, to a point where, you know, the window of opportunity that this person that I love had to make changes, his housing, transportation, plan, it passed without him realizing it. And I've really started asking the Lord a lot recently. Father, I know there's areas of blindness in my life. I'm not at that place yet, but there's definitely things that I am not seeing. And I wanted to share this just because, in spite of the fact that, you know, this theme of our ability to be blind, for things to sneak up on us, it's one of the foundational threads that's throughout the Bible. It is also something that's been talked about for thousands of years. You can find it in Greek philosophy. You can find it in yesterday's New York Times. And yet, how many of us, if I say, you know, how are you doing? Do you feel like you're doing a pretty good job? You know, like, do you feel you have a pretty good read on, you know, on yourself, on your life, on your circumstances? I would say, oh yeah, I do. Statistics say that the vast majority of people say, yeah, I'm doing a pretty good job. I have a pretty good accurate perception on my life. And yet there's things like this that show us that we don't. Just to follow up. So the two changes that I've made in my life is that I got a rowing machine in the basement, hoping that maybe I start exercising a little bit more. And I called my youngest son and asked him to explain what ChatGPT is. So I don't know if that makes me any less blind, but probably not. I'm guessing not. Jumping back into Proverbs with a different kind of blindness this time, but also one that we kind of might not think of as being blind. Proverbs 29:1 reads, whoever remains stiff-necked after many rebukes will suddenly be destroyed without remedy. Now, this doesn't look like it's about blindness, but bear with me here. And I'm going to borrow a comment from Tim Keller again. Tim Keller says, a stiff-necked ox or horse is one that doesn't bend its neck at the direction of the driver, so it makes itself useless or even dangerous. This metaphor applies to those of us who are stubborn, who are wise in our own eyes. Because salvation is by faith and repentance, not our good works and performance, in one sense, anyone at any time can turn to God. But a person can spiritually drift until they are too hard-hearted to consider real repentance. While God's door to hear our repentance is never shut, our window of opportunity to produce it can be. If we ever sense the impulse to repent, we should respond immediately and not presume in our pride that we will be capable of it at any time and place that we choose. So my question here is, like, how many of us have been stubborn? I am going to raise my hand. Is stubbornness the plant that's visible on the outside, but the root is our blindness to our pride? Another look at this that I want to touch on is because blindness is not always a conviction of areas that we need to improve on. Sometimes we're blind to what God has really done for us. You know, there's a term called justification. And that is a whole, not just a sermon, but a whole sermon series on its own. But justification is the idea that every single one of us deep down needs to feel that there's a justification for our life, that we're here for a reason. Like why are we here? And it's very, very easy to think, well, I'm a mom, or I'm a husband. I'm my purpose. I'm getting my sense of value because, you know, I'm a lawyer, or I'm a teacher, and that gives me value. But there is something radically unique about the Christian gospel. Our justification, our purpose for being here, does not come from us. We cannot produce it. We cannot create our own value. It comes from the Lord, and it comes from faith in Him alone, period. So when you've accepted the Lord, what happens with justification is that God takes the only righteous, perfect example, Jesus Christ, and He bestows it on you. So when God looks at you, He does not see us. He doesn't see our faults. He sees Jesus. And sometimes that blindness, like, I think it's a lifelong struggle to receive that, to receive how much God can love us without us doing anything, without us earning it, without us doing good works. I think it's as much as a struggle for Christians as for non-Christians, for young, for old. It's part of the human condition to need to feel valuable. The Christian gospel is the only source that says you don't need to work to find enlightenment and value. It is given. Your justification for being, for waking up and breathing, is from Jesus Christ. It's from the Lord. I have a lot more that I could say, but I want to be conscientious of time here. And Alec and the worship team, if you guys want to come back up, I would invite you to do that. A couple thoughts in conclusion here. I think I wanted to touch on this because Proverbs has an amazing amount of wisdom in it, but it's also easy to go through it, and it can appear to imply that we can make ourselves good through our efforts. But wisdom is a gift of grace. No one can make themselves good. Proverbs 29:20, verse 9, says, "Who can say, I've kept my heart pure, I'm clean without sin?" And the answer is no one. No one can. Romans 3:10 says, "There is no one righteous, not even one." And these scriptures are meant to be a comfort and a hope, because the Christian gospel is the great equalizer. The wise don't divide the world into good and bad. The moral and the immoral are alienated from God, but in different ways. When I read that article in the New Yorker and I read that sentence, "What tool, however imperfect, do we have for coping with despair?" First of all, I was overwhelmed with just sadness, because I know that there are so many people that feel that way. Part of me wanted to write the author and say, that tool you're looking for, it's called the Bible. And it is going to absolutely change your life. I'd like you to go ahead. I'm inviting you to stand up and pray with me. Dear Heavenly Father, how I perceive myself and others has huge implications for decision-making and relationships. Please humble me and comfort me. Open my eyes and heart to your wisdom. Make me a chief repenter. Let me be the first to admit my fault, to repent quickly, without grumbling, without excuses, without bitterness. Please begin to reproduce your holy character in me. Give me an undivided heart that I may fear your name. Father, make yourself real to me, that I have a burning desire to do right and to be holy for your sake, for no other reason than just to delight you. Help me walk in your wisdom, Father. Open my eyes, my ears, and my heart. Father, I pray that every person here today hears what they need to hear. We ask in Jesus' name, amen. Well, I'd love to close out service today just with worship.
Blindness, and the Lord wants to open, he's opening my eyes, and you just want to acknowledge that. Would you close your eyes for a moment and just take a moment? And there's something I feel like the Lord, even in just acknowledging, maybe even looking up at me or putting a hand up, because it takes courage. You can't passively embrace what the Lord is speaking to you today and hope that it goes away. And that's like, it takes courage to acknowledge, like, yeah, I think I've been a little blind to some of the things in my life. Maybe my pride has been louder than the voice of the Lord, the conviction of his spirit, or the tenderness of his grace for me. And so if that's you, and you're just like, Chase, I want to acknowledge, like, I have been walking in blindness, but today, like, I want to step into a new day of seeing more accurately the perception, the perspective of the scriptures. I just want to acknowledge that. If that's you, will you look up at me? I can know who I'm praying for, or raise a hand so I can, like, this is what, yeah. Sinned, if I'd never walked in spiritual blindness and never walked in opposition of you, but Jesus took it so that today I could stand here, we could stand here and receive the gift of grace to have a renewing of vision, to have our eyes being opened to see. God, I pray for courage. God, I pray for that man or woman who is having a hard time acknowledging. I pray that humility would begin to invade. I pray that pride would die. Less of me, more of you. You increase, I decrease. God, I pray for just a revival of humility to begin to rise up in the church. And that we aren't lost, that some of the most spiritual people in the Gospels were religious men and women who thought that they had it figured out, but the outside wasn't as pure as the inside, or the outside was impure. The outside was pure, but the inside was impure. God, you wanted to do more with just the behavior, what it looked like. I pray that that happens today in this place, in this room, that we receive it. Jesus, we pray. Amen. 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 Thank you for the word. Thanks for encouraging us and challenging us today. If you need prayer, I'm going to invite our prayer team. They're going to be up front here on both sides of the room. I'd love to pray for you, pray over you, continue to have an opportunity to lift you up today. And as you step into this week, be courageous. Maybe you need to tell somebody, hey, like, God's been dealing with me and convicting me and helping me see that I haven't really been seeing. And I want you to know it's happening, it's stirring up in me. Sometimes it's just speaking that and sharing that begins to do a deepened work in your heart and in your soul. Go share it. Go tell somebody what God is saying, what God is doing. Open the eyes of your church. Open the eyes of this city. Open the eyes of this county. We want to see you. In Jesus' name.